So today I would like to address the problem of aviation, climate change and human rights. I will talk a bit about inequality in the context with aviation. Then I will briefly mention the regulation of international aviation. And in the last part of the presentation, I would like to talk about climate litigation cases connected to aviation. Even though aviation is responsible only for approximately 2.5% of the global anthropogenic CO2 emissions, in my opinion, it is closely related to the problem of inequality. Gessling and Hampe argue that in 2018, only 11% of world population took a flight, and they also argue that approximately 1% of all population is probably responsible for more than half of the total CO2 emissions from passenger air travel. So this means that a relatively large group of people actually never take a flight, and a small percentage of population create a quite high CO2 emissions. Also, the international aviation, and there is problem of private aircrafts and business travelers. This problem or this question was again open when the summit in Glasgow started a few weeks ago. People were discussing how much emissions created the flights of the world leaders who were meeting there. Some people proposed that these CO2 emissions were not so high if we look at the energy sectors, for example, in the Czech Republic. But I think the international aviation show us that the inequality is a problem in the climate change in general. We have a problem of so-called high emitters. Chancel and Piketty argue that the top 10 emitters in the world account for approximately 45% of global CO2 emissions, while the bottom 50% of emitters contribute only 13%. Of course, the international climate change law regime knows the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities. But this principle is more used to distinguish between countries, because among the parties to the international conventions, and not among people in one state, let's say. What is also interesting is that Chancel and Piketty argue that especially the high emitters from 5 countries are really relevant. And they mention the United States, Canada, Saudi Arabia, Singapore, and Luxembourg. And if you are aware of the Kyoto Protocol, which I think you are, you would probably know that Singapore and Saudi Arabia did not have responsibilities under the Kyoto Protocol. And United States did not ratify the protocol, and Canada in the end withdrew from the protocol. So actually, these countries were not in compliance with the Kyoto Protocol. And also, the emissions from international aviation are supposed to grow. Despite the COVID-19 situation, we are expecting an increase in international aviation. So we will see how this will continue. One more argument to show that the aviation is a problem. These are the busiest air roads within the Europe, and you can see that they are actually the short distance flights, where we have usually a really good railway connection established, for example, between Berlin and Munich, Paris and Toulouse, Madrid and Barcelona. We have really good train connection, and also probably maybe you are aware that actually the short distance flights create more CO2 emissions per kilometer than the long distance flights, because there are also CO2 emissions connected with takeoff and landing. So this was quite interesting for me to see this map, and is based on the Eurostat data. Now I will just briefly introduce the principle of common but differentiated responsibilities in the international climate change legal regime. This, of course, was established in the UNFCCC convention, under which the developed countries should take the lead in combating climate change. However, the Kyoto Protocol gave obligations only to the Annex 1 parties. They were having the quantified emissions limitation, And under the Paris Agreement, actually, all parties have their obligations, but the developed country parties should continue taking the lead by undertaking economy-wide absolute emission reduction targets. And now I will look at international aviation in these international conventions. The UNFCCC was aiming to address or regulate all anthropogenic emissions of greenhouse gases not controlled by the Montreal Protocol in all relevant sectors, including the transport sector. However, the Kyoto Protocol excluded the international bunker emissions or international bunker fuels emissions. And the responsibility to limit or reduce these emissions was given to International Civil Aviation Organization and the International Maritime Organization. And under this Paris Agreement, this scheme, let's say, is maintained. Domestic aviation is regulated within the nationally NDCs. However, the international bunker emissions continue to be regulated by International Civil Aviation Organization and International Maritime Organization in the case of international shipping. Moreover, the international aviation is having a unique taxation regime. There is an exemption for the tax for the fuel, for the kerosene. This is originally under the Chicago Convention, even though many argue that it is not so strict in the convention as it is now regulated around the world. And also there is not much value added tax on tickets for aviation. There are some efforts to regulate the emissions from international aviation. There are some efforts under the International Civil Organization, Civil Aviation Organization. It came with the CORSIA offsetting system. Then there are also some proposals on the EU level lately from July of this year. And there are also some efforts for more sustainable fuels, but we will see how these efforts will end. And now I would like to talk about some cases of climate litigation related to aviation. I classify them in five groups, let's say. There was one case in Austria about which was already talking Professor Eva Schlesteindl relating the taxation regime. Then there was one a bit similar case, I would say, connected with the COVID-19 bailout in Netherlands. And then there is the largest group of the cases related to expansion of airports. I will also talk about these cases. And then there are two more cases about which I will not talk today so much. One is connected with, let's say, greenwashing. This was a case from the United Kingdom where Ryanair was advertising its services as being green or the greenest from all airlines, etc. And also there is the famous decision related to EU ETS, which was decided by the Court of Justice of European Union in 2011. So the Austrian case related to taxation regime already mentioned Professor Eva Schlesteindl. The application was to the Austrian Constitutional Court in 2020 related to the tax exemption on international and domestic flights or aviation sector. The case was dismissed as inadmissible, and the applicants were arguing that the tax exemptions contribute to climate change by making aviation less expensive than, for example, the railway sector. And they were arguing that the consequences pose an imminent and foreseeable threat to their lives, and also that it constitutes a preferential treatment for aviation sector and violates the principle of equality before the law. Then the similar case, or I think I see there are some similarities, is from Netherlands. This case was filed to the Hague District Court in 2020 regarding the COVID-19 bailout package for the KLM airline, which was granted to the KLM airline from the Dutch state. And the plaintiffs were arguing that it violates the state's duty of care to prevent high risk of dangerous climate change by failing to attach binding climate conditions and therefore it's violating human rights. This lawsuit was also rejected by the Hague District Court. The court pointed that the state has a high level of discretion, and also that the Paris Agreement does not commit to reduction of emissions from international aviation. And the last group of the cases is connected with the expansions of airports. I will talk about three cases, about cases from the United Kingdom, Czech Republic, and Austria, which was also already mentioned here today. But there are more of these cases. I have seen that there was a case in Ireland or India, so this group is relatively large. The first case which I would like to address is the case of a third runway at Heathrow Airport, which was planned in the Airport National Policy Statement, which was designed by the Secretary of State for Transport under the Planning Act, and it was challenged by several NGOs. First, the Court of Appeal actually agreed with the plaintiffs, but the Supreme Court later that year overruled the decision. The Airport National Policy Statement was challenged for not taking into account the Paris Agreement and not addressing the post-2050 emissions. And the Court of Appeal actually ruled that the Paris Agreement should have been taken into account, as it is a government policy under the Planning Act and also under the SEA directive. And also it said that according to the precautionary principle, the post-2050 emissions should have been addressed in the statement. However, the Supreme Court ruled that the Paris Agreement cannot be considered to be government policy, as it is not prepared by the relevant departments on a government-wide basis. And also it ruled that addressing the Paris Agreement could be too much detail disabling effective public consultation. So the Supreme Court stated or ruled that it was sufficient to include the UK Climate Change Act from 2008, even though this act at that time was having lower climate targets than the Paris Agreement. This act has been later changed, so we will see if the court will decide differently. Also, the Supreme Court ruled that it was lawful to don't address the post-2050 emissions, as the UK's policy for these emissions was only under development at the time when the Airport National Policy Statement was prepared. The second case which I would like to mention is the case of the Schwechat Airport, which was already mentioned here in the morning. What is interesting is that the plan for the third runway here was approved by the lower Austrian government and not by the central government as in the British case. And it was the plan for the third runway was challenged for being contrary to the Austria's target to reduce transport emissions by 2020. And also in this case, the Federal Administrative Court agreed with the plaintiffs, but the decision of the Federal Administrative Court was found, with errors by the Austrian Constitutional Court. The Austrian Constitutional Court stated that only emissions from takeoff and landing could be considered, because the Paris Agreement and Kyoto Protocol do not include international aviation. Here we can see the same argument again. And also the Austrian Constitutional Court ruled that the Climate Protection Act establishing the target implements the EU law, which does not apply to international aviation either. Also, the Austrian Constitutional Court said that the Paris Agreement and Kyoto Protocol do not have direct effect and therefore is not legally binding for the lower Austrian government, for the regional government. There were also other arguments which mentioned Professor Schulek-Steindl in the morning, but I will not address these. And then we have our Czech case, the case of expansion of the Václav Havel Airport. This plan for a parallel runway at the Václav Havel Airport was defined in the principles of territorial development of the Central Bohemian region, so again by the regional government. Here we can see the tools of the Czech urban planning. So here it was challenged the principles of territorial development of the Central Bohemian region. And the Prague Regional Court granted the motion to annul these principles based on omission of sources of noise, however, rejected the climate arguments on procedural grounds, but decided to comment on them. The Prague Court referred to the Schwechat case and said that the Paris Agreement and Kyoto Protocol do not have a direct effect, and only emissions from takeoff and landing should be considered. Also, the Prague court referred to the Heathrow case and said that in this case, the Czech national land use policy was not being challenged. But what is interesting, according to the existing Czech case law, to challenge the Czech national land use policy is really problematic, if not impossible. And the individual intentions which are in this national land use policy should be addressed through regional plans. So here I see a conflict because the judicial review of the Czech national land use policy is not possible to review if the principles of territorial development of the region are in compliance with the Paris Agreement is also not possible. So I think we have here a potential conflict with the right to a fair trial. And my last point, in these cases, we have seen many types of arguments, legal arguments regarding the national law, legal arguments regarding the UN international legal climate regime, and some more arguments. I would like to just briefly address the legal arguments regarding the UN international legal climate regime. First of them was that the international climate regime does not commit to reduction of emissions from international aviation. In this sense, I think we can try to rely more on the fundamental rights combined with scientific knowledge. Professor Mary Wood from Oregon argues that the Paris Agreement actually lead to so-called catastrophic scenario, and therefore we should more rely on the scientific knowledge, which is asking for one or maximum 1.5 degrees Celsius warming. We can also address the emissions from domestic aviation, and we can also address the emissions from takeoff and landing. You can see that they are approximately 25% of all the emissions. And if we look at them in the local context, together with some additional indirect emissions, because every airport is connected with additional transport, of course, these emissions are not so low, even though they have not been addressed by the courts. And the second argument is that international climate regime does not have direct effect. So here we can challenge the plans based on national or local targets. We can also try to challenge the national plans if it's possible. And also I would like to bring your attention to the just now mentioned case Milieudefensie et al. Versus Dutch, where the Hague District Court actually found some, let's say, obligations, or it said that the, also the non-state party stakeholders should contribute to mitigating the climate change. So I think, of course, also the regions and municipalities should also contribute to the climate change mitigation. So my conclusion is that maybe in the climate change litigation, we should put greater emphasis on the role of science and not just rely on the Paris Agreement. I also think that it is necessary to ensure a full judicial review of authority decisions. And I also think that we should involve all actors, not just the states. Thank you very much.